Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us. This is Sipping Tea with Nat and Z. I'm Nat.
And I am Z. Hello.
Hello. Howdy.
What's going on? What is going on? Well, even though you won't hear this until near closer to Thanksgiving.
Yes.
Today is actually Halloween, which is my daughter's Christmas. And so she's like really full on Halloween mode. Everything she's watching today has to do with Halloween. She's like obsessed with Halloween. She's been talking about Halloween since last year. So this is her Super Bowl, okay? This is her Super Bowl. This is exactly what she's been waiting for.
Is she dressed up already?
No, she has soccer. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah, so she's in her soccer uniform right now. So, you know, well, I mean, technically, I could say she's Ted Lasso. She's
There you go. See?
I can say she's what's his name? Oh gosh, Jamie Tart. Oh, you don't watch Ted Lasso. Anybody that's listening, Ted Lasso, awesome show. It's in hiatus until the next season.
Oh, watch good it. Time to catch up.
Good time to catch up.
Okay,
it's Apple TV. Mm-hmm. But if you're like us and have other ways around,
yes,
watching it without getting an Apple TV subscription.
Duly noted.
You can do that. And then this next week is really hectic. Well, I'm not gonna say really hectic for me, but I just have a lot of stuff that I have to get done. Like it's fall officially. It's been fall, but it's really fall, so I need to switch out my closet.
For my
fall stuff. Mm-hmm. I switch out my closet.
My closet
isn't large enough to
really
hold all of my clothes, so
and
I
fall
have
is our
to.
Favorite.
Yes, I have to switch it out, and my fall closet is beyond massive, so I have to get rid of some stuff. I've added some pieces to my collection.
Mm-hmm.
I'm really trying to work on having a capsule collection.
Ooh, capsule! Do tell, be tell what the capsule collection is.
So we talked about that, I think, in
decluttering. Yeah. Yes, we did.
And it's basically just having the basic pieces that you need
foundation.
Add pieces. Yeah, the foundation. Mm-hmm. So like maybe a black skirt, a blazer, you know, some nice boots, a white button-up crisp tee, you know, just things like that. So. I'm trying to build a capsule wardrobe. So
I like it. I need to do that myself.
And adding some trendy things in it. I got a shacket.
Oh, a shacket.
Yes. I think that's what they call it. It's the flannel long jackets. So I bought one of those from
Amazon. I saw that. I was eyeing that.
Yes.
I was eyeing a shacket myself.
Yes. So I bought one of those. I bought some pleather tights. Where am I going with these things? I don't know.
But the same place I'm going with my pleather tights.
Yes. Okay. So we can be together with our pleather tights.
Ain't going no damn where.
So I'm getting new flooring this week. I have to go get my car looked at. I'm hoping that everything's okay because I've been without a car note for a while and I really don't want a
car note. Let me tell you, I just started. I've never had one before, and this is my second payment for my new car that I just bought, and I don't know how y'all do this. I'm thankful that I haven't had one before, but
car notes is devil.
Overrated.
They are, but I did say the next car I get, I'm going to lease. Because I'd rather lease, but you know. But anyway, so pause. Last week we were all over the place because we didn't have our producer. Our producer is here, and she's like, "Y'all need
to
wrap it up."
Because you all know last week
we were wrap it up. So let's wrap it up and talk about today's episode, which is gratitude.
Yes.
So the tea on the tea of the day, it is. A disclaimer that we're about to give you.
Because y'all know that we need to make sure that we frame this appropriately when we tell you what the tea is, okay?
Yes. So, you know, talk to your doctor before adding tea into your daily life. Mm-hmm. It's not a substitute for medication. We're not affiliated with any of these companies, nor are these official endorsements. So, what is the tea on the table?
So, on the table, we have Gratitude Organic Tea. We can find them. We'll put that website up for you. Their mission is to influence the way people eat and drink as a component of better managing their overall health. That's a nice mission. I like that. Their eco-friendly packaged tea. They're rich in antioxidants, which we know is very important and a great characteristic of tea, and carefully balanced with minimal amounts of organic cane sugar, organically grown stevia. I use stevia. Tea is especially blended to enhance heart health, weight loss. Hey, come through. And enhance energy. Flavors mint, peach, green, and berry. I'm going to have to look y'all up.
The peach is really, well, let me preface. The peach is the only one that I've tasted.
Okay.
The peach is good. It's mm-hmm. not like, it's a hint of sugar. So if you're someone who likes like sweet tea, mm-hmm. this probably isn't going to be for you. Because they're already pre-blended. So it might not be for you. These aren't like loose leaf teas. These are like in a carton. Like if you go to like the London Fog tea latte that we've been boasting about that Starbucks has, that's in
It's like stores. Okay.
It's in a carton like that. I like the peach tea. Like I said, if you're someone who's trying to reduce your sugar intake, really watch your weight and stuff like that, this is definitely, I would say, for you. Oh. They have the mint, the peach, the green, and the berry.
Gonna have to check that out. And then mm-hmm. we also wanted to highlight Grace and Gratitude Tea Company. We talked about them briefly like a couple months ago. This is a neighbor of mine. It's her tea company. And their concept stems from love for high-quality tea, holistic wellness, and cultivating connections with fellow wives, moms, and busy women. They have tea, clothing, and tea accessories. Check them out. They have the whole cornucopia of immersing yourself in the tea culture.
Yes.
So,
yes.
I highly recommend them.
And we'll put that, like you said, those two websites up on our social media. Get into some hot tea.
Yes. What's good?
Okay. So let's see. What do I have for hot tea? First, Lil Nas X's marketing team is just like the greatest of all time. To continue rolling out his newest album, he has a song called Someone to Love. And so he had a whole Maury segment with the runoff and everything that's based around this song. And the premise is he fell in love with a young gentleman that he was playing football with. He comes to find out that young gentleman had a whole wife with a child. And so he decided to bring them both to Maury. So if you haven't checked out that segment, I highly suggest you do. It is pure entertainment. I thoroughly enjoyed it. And it is just peak, I say, Lil Nas X. So again, it's on YouTube. It's probably on Maury's page. Go check it out if you can. I feel like that's always going to be in the hot topics. I mean, on hot topics, listen to me, hot tea. The versus battles that, so let me preface this first. There was a versus battle this week, and it was Chaka Khan versus Stephanie Mills. And I got secondhand embarrassment, and so I stopped watching it a good 15, 20 minutes in. Chaka Khan clearly was high as a giraffe's coochie, and I just had second-hand embarrassment for Auntie, so I couldn't watch it. And I go on Twitter, and I see Twitter is just in full, and Black Twitter, let's preface that, was just in full foolishness. They called her Chiraka Khan. So, it's just, if you want to take a gander at it, if you didn't get to watch it, YouTube is probably your best friend with this. I'm pretty sure you're going to be able to find that there if you haven't already seen clips on IG. I just couldn't get through the whole thing. The next versus battle will be Bone Thugs and Harmony versus 3-6 Mafia. I asked for 3-6 Mafia and UGK. Or UGK and 8-Ball and MJG. I did not ask for 3-6 Mafia and Bone Thugs and Harmony. They did have some beef at some point. And I think they squashed that beef. So maybe this is part of why they are battling in verses. But again, we'll see. King Richard just came out. It was supposed to go straight to theaters. But I believe still because we're in this pandemic and people aren't going to the movie theaters as much as I think the movie industry had hoped, it went straight to HBO Max. And because of that, I'll say kudos to Will Smith because he gave the team bonuses because they weren't going to get, I guess, as much money as they would had it just gone straight to theaters. It was a really good film. Will Smith was probably going to be nominated, or if not nominated, he will be in talks of being nominated for his portrayal of Serena's and Serena Venus and Serena's father in this movie. I felt like it was more of a Venus Williams, Richard Williams story more than it was a Richard Williams story or a Serena Venus and Richard Williams story, but it was really good. Check it out if you can. Adele has dropped her album 30, which has been on constant repeat. There are a few songs that I just was not prepared for, ready for. I ain't ready to talk about. I'm still trying to wrap my mind and my feelings around it. But the songs for me that like got me very emotional was My Little Love. That song she's talking to her son actually, and she's talking about the fact that her and his father are no longer going to be together, and then her talking about how she feels like a failure in that whole situation. Then Woman Like Me, whoo, Adele on there talking that shit. I suggest if you were beefing with your husband's significant others, whoever, don't listen to that song, especially if you want to patch things up, because you probably won't. But that is definitely a good song. And let's see, All Night Parking, which is supposed to be an interlude, but I really wish it was a the longer song. I thoroughly enjoyed that. And I feel like a lot there are a lot of songs on a lot of people's albums that tend to be interludes that I wish were full songs. Like I know Solange has a interlude on her last album that I so wish was a full song. So get that album if you can. Recently, as in like yesterday, I think the or not yesterday, but relatively recently, there is indications that they are going to do a Different Strokes live. Like they've done with the Jeffersons and with Good Times. And initially, I'm not, let's preface this, I'm not a big fan of these live remakes, but this one I'm going to be here for because it's going to be Kevin Hart playing Gary Coleman and Damon Wayans reprising the role of Willis. So I fully expect full on shenanigans, and I will be here for it and I will watch it. And then, lastly, these two stories, if you know these people, if you don't, I'm pretty sure you've seen these stories all over the internet. Young Dolph, which is short for Adolph, he was tragically murdered in Memphis going to buy cookies. And it's a very sad turn of events because this man is a father in his 30s. He's been with his wife, I believe, or his partner since they were like maybe in high school. They have two beautiful children. And I just wish that we would get, I don't know, this senseless violence, this, you know, constant barrage of news of these young black men getting gunned down and over things that have no significance, no importance. It's just very sad and very tragic. And I really hope we can get beyond this at some point. And then, of course, even if you don't know these people, you've seen it all over the internet. Dani Leigh and DaBaby brought their full toxic co-parenting situation to the internet. And it was unfortunate because there were a lot of things that happened in front of their child, which is a whole 3-month-old baby. And I am not here for it. Like, you know, I don't care. You know, a lot of people were saying, well, that's what she did because she came out with this song called Yellow Bone is What He Likes and all this stuff. Yeah, that was ignorance. Fully get that. But I can separate that situation from the fact that this is a mother who's probably going through postpartum still. And this man is kicking her out of his home. And not just her. He's kicking her and their 3-month-old out of the home. He's videotaping this and then putting it on social media. Now, if you felt like she was going to be physical and you wanted to videotape her for your safety, that's fine. But then to take that video and then to broadcast it on the internet, to me makes it seem like you want people to have this narrative like she's the crazy one. And that to me is a clear classic sign of someone who is a narcissist and someone who likes to gaslight people. So I really fully hope that she heals from this situation. She gets far away from him as possible. She does whatever she needs to do to keep the co-parenting relationship as civil as possible. I hope she finds love, peace, and light. And I hope she leaves that toxic Negro alone, because this ain't it. And just keep your business off of social media, period. And that's all I have for the hot tea of the day.
Oh, excuse me. My. This sounds like a lot going on there, I must say. So we're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, we'll jump right into our tea time segment. Right. So, like we said, this episode is about gratitude. And, you know, being grateful is in line with Thanksgiving. So this is also our Thanksgiving episode. So what is gratitude? It's the expression of appreciation for what one has. And it can be a spontaneous feeling, but increasingly research demonstrates, you know, it's a practice. It's something that you do. It's a conscious effort that you really have to think about and actively do. You know, making...
Wait, can you say that again? A conscious...
Conscious. Yes. It's not just go with the flow. Like, you really... Right. It's an active gesture that has to be made, whether to yourself or to somebody. And counting your blessings, being grateful for someone's presence, what their actions are towards you. You know, and it's an emotion, we hope, that makes you feel happier. Because some people may feel that gratitude is like... Like I shouldn't have to give it for whatever reason, but it's supposed to make you feel happier. You know, it doesn't necessarily consist of grand gestures. It's the little things. Little things are so, so important. Just a smile, a quick, you know, girl, you look good today. Just, and that person is like, oh, thank you. That's just made that person feel happy. You know what I mean?
You know, with that, it just popped into my head, and mm-hmm. I remember our friends one of our friends in particular used to laugh at me, but it said that, you know, it was a good thing to do. My grandmother was big on sending thank you cards. Like, if somebody did something, we would have to send like a thank you card or pick up a phone and call them and say, thank you for X, Y, and Z. Thank you for doing this. And initially it was like one of those things. Of course, when you're younger, you're like, I don't have to call. I don't have to do this. But it's definitely something I appreciate that now was instilled in me now. Like, I really do.
That is so true. When Will and I were dating and we were hanging out with the kids, and my parents, we were getting closer to the whole marriage thing, and my parents would start getting them gifts of sorts when they kind of realized that we were going to be together and whatever. And when we got them gifts, I said, okay, well, did you guys say thank you? And they were like, huh? I'm like, did you write a note? They were like, what? And I was really kind of surprised that they're like, yeah, we said thank you. And the whole purpose or the gestures of going through and writing the note, it came back full-fledged, like you said, because it was instilled in me. And then I'm passing it on to them to make sure that they do it now going forward. So it definitely is definitely important. And it doesn't cost a dime. It doesn't cost you a thing. But it has such huge effects. And that are beneficial to those that are receiving it. And then those that are saying it, because it makes you be mindful of what you're doing. And it goes beyond a sense of self-worth, self-efficacy, and it definitely builds trust between individuals as well. It creates a giving attitude, a way to express gratitude. Synonyms for gratitude include acknowledgement. Acknowledgement is so important, because then you're an adult. People just want to be acknowledged. That's a core. That is like the crux of a lot of problems nowadays.
A lot of problems is just
not acknowledging. Oh my goodness, that would solve so many things. Just it would. Did you hear me? Just acknowledge. Appreciativeness, grace. Grace is huge. Gracefulness, gratefulness, recognition, responsiveness, and requital. That's a good one. That's a good SAT word, y'all. Mm-hmm. You know, and you need to understand the difference between gratitude and appreciation, though. Gratitude is the feeling of being grateful, and appreciation is acting on my feeling of being grateful. So just be mindful of the two. Sometimes people use them interchangeably, and gratitude is the feeling, appreciation is the act and the action. And then there's three stages of gratitude. Recognition, which is the first step in recognizing that you're going to be okay. And it's realizing that in spite of your struggles, you still have a life worth living. Just recognizing where you are and being appreciative of the space that you're in, because it could always be going left on in a drop of a dime. Mm-hmm. And, you know, make you sure you kind of see the glass half full. I can't tell you how many times going through my particular health challenges, and when I go see my doctors, they're like, you know, you have a really good attitude about this, because otherwise, I don't know how, because if I were you, I'd probably be going batshit crazy. Now, having a medical professional tell me that, I don't know how good that is. Just saying, but, you know, for them to acknowledge as a healthcare professional that your attitude about how you see life, if it's half full or half empty, can have a huge impact on your view of life and how you interact with people, your day-to-day, is just so important, and that, you know, that you're in a better position than you may think. And then there's acknowledgement, which is the second stage. And you feel you see the light at the end of the tunnel. You're like, okay, I've acknowledged the glass is half full, and now I'm realizing, okay, things can get better. This is going to end at some point, I hope. And it gives you encouraging steps to keep moving forward. Keep swimming, you know, like Dory, keep swimming.
I think that is the part that a lot of people get stuck on when it mm-hmm. comes to gratitude for themselves. Mm-hmm. Like you said, you're grateful that you're alive. Be grateful that, you know, recognize that you're going to be okay. But I think sometimes the acknowledgement that there's going to be a light at the end of the tunnel is sometimes hard for people to get to.
Yes.
Some people get stuck in this stage.
Very much so.
It's hard. And then it's because they get stuck in this stage, it's hard for them to then transition to that third step.
Right. The appreciation of the situation and for what it is, and appreciating the people in your life who've been there for you through all those other stages, and getting a sense of renewed strength, because it's a trajectory that you have to go through. But like Z said, that acknowledgement can really leave you stuck and not give you the strength to go further and appreciate what you have to be in that place. And it's huge to make sure that you be mindful of these things and understand why it matters to be in this space.
Yes. And, you know, that is a big thing, why gratitude matters. You know, a lot of people say, well, I say thank you, or I say mm-hmm. I appreciate you. But there are other reasons. And I mean, and you say those things because you're like, okay, that should make you feel better. But there are other reasons why gratitude matters, and why you should practice it in your life, and why you should be mindful of it. We always talk about mindfulness. Mindfulness is a big thing for me, because when you just have to be present and aware of everything, right?
It's so hard sometimes.
It is hard. Gratitude unshackles us from toxic emotions.
Mm.
And I'm going to say that again. Gratitude unshackles. Take the shackles off
my feet. I like to dance. Just want to praise it. I was thinking the same thing, Reef.
So, and that's hard. It's hard. But when you start to practice gratitude, it's harder for you to ruminate on those negative experiences, those negative feelings.
True. Because if you're in that positive space, it's hard for you to, for those thoughts to coexist.
It absolutely is. Gratitude helps even if you don't share it. And what I mean by don't share it is, sometimes you could be thankful and maybe not express that gratitude to the person you're thankful for or to.
Mm-hmm.
So it helps you appreciate the people in your life, and will shift your focus away from negative feelings and thoughts.
So important. Okay?
I think, excuse me, I'm so sorry. I think this also helps with people who've lost parents or loved ones, right? And you may not be able to express or share your gratitude for what they've done in your life, because they're no longer here in the physical. But I think it's still important to practice gratitude in those situations, because it will help you turn those negative feelings about maybe that possible relationship into positive ones.
That's really, I think that's such a key important place.
Yes.
A point that you gave, because I think folks feel like they can't do anything once someone has passed on, or they can't tell that person, but there still are ways to honor that person and be grateful and show gratitude that is so key, because I think a lot of people get stuck there.
Yeah, they do. I think so too. Gratitude's benefits can sometimes take time. So you don't know that, well, what a lot of people think is that once you express your gratitude, it's like instantaneous. You're going to start feeling these warm feelings, but that doesn't always happen. But the long-term effects, once they kick in, are going to drastically improve your overall mental health. So if you start to practice gratitude on a more daily basis and you're not, you feel like those endorphins aren't kicking in, give it time. And I trust me, when they do kick in, it's going to have a huge impact on the way you feel and the way you think. It has been shown that gratitude has lasting effects on the brain. There's been research done on this, and it's been shown that when people feel more grateful, their brain activity is distinct from brain activity related to guilt. So just think about that. Your brain, your brain is affected by gratitude, okay? Gratitude actually provides stronger self-control. It trains your mind to recognize that it values your future self more than it values immediate gratification.
That's a beat.
I think that, yeah, that's important. If you take, just take a beat and think about that, like self-control, right? Is huge. A lot of people lack it. I lack self-control in a lot of areas in my life, right?
We all do.
But if you think about that and you just practice gratitude, you'll find that, you know, you say to yourself, I'm thankful for this body that I have. And so what I'm not going to do is partake in this particular activity because the, yes, I might be, I might have instant immediate gratification now, but my future self is going to hate that I did this.
Yeah.
So let me be grateful to the future self, be grateful for what I have now and not engage in this because it's not going to be good for me.
Right. That's a big one. Especially now, instant gratification of today. People want everything now. Yeah. I want it
now.
Everything now. Everything now. Just, no. Some things take time.
They do. Gratitude can enhance our overall sense of well-being. Again, this is study, research, scientists, science people, science. I know a lot of us don't believe in science.
Not these days. For some reason. Lord help us.
The science is real, and the world is round.
Right. Thank you. Thank you. Because there are some people that do not think that still. Okay.
Studies have revealed that those who practice gratitude are 25% happier, have 23% lower levels of stress hormone, of the stress hormone cortisol. And cortisol, if you haven't been aware of cortisol or what it does, that is actually one of those hormones that will make you gain weight.
It gets in the belly area. That's where it goes.
Right.
That's
yes.
Belly fat.
So gratitude could help you lose weight.
Hello.
If you look at it that way. People who practice gratitude sleep for 10% longer and 15% better.
Wow.
They exercise more. At least an hour and a half more per week. And they have 10 to 16% lower blood pressure. And they endure 10% fewer stress-related illnesses.
You see that, y'all? Gratitude is the bomb.
So you, all of this other stuff that we were talking about, if you're like, yeah, but I need data. I need facts. I need the hardcore facts. I need numbers.
That's the facts, Jack.
Those are the numbers. Scientists are telling you that if you practice gratitude, your health, your physical health,
that's amazing,
will improve.
All on your outlook. And how you definitely take in things and, and express thanks for things. That's amazing.
It is. And you know what? Just to take a pause. When we look at all of the conditions that people go through in their lives. And I'm not discounting. Diseases are real. And they happen. But like you said, I feel like I'll share something with you. Everybody knows I talk about this a lot. That my mother died at 44 from cancer. It spread. It started out as breast cancer. She went into remission. She was diagnosed at 37. She went into remission a few times between 37 and 44 and actually passed away at 44. The cancer started to spread to places where it just, there was nothing left. Like it was, it got bone cancer. And at that point in time, we're not as advanced with bone cancer as we are today. And so it just wreaked havoc on her body. And I firmly believe that my mom was not in a place, a good place mentally. And because of that, her condition deteriorated faster. Mm-hmm. And there were some other things, but I think that that was a huge piece of the puzzle. And I say those things to say, your attitude matters.
It does.
And like you said, your doctors tell you to have consistently have a positive attitude.
Yeah.
Because your attitude can create situations, good or bad, for you and for your physical. Stress, I feel, brings on a lot of diseases.
Man.
Because I just told you, cortisol is a stress hormone. And then you gain weight. Mm-hmm. And then you're diabetic.
Yep.
And then you have all these other health chain conditions. Reaction. I feel like cancer is one of those things that is stems from having some stress in your life.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't believe anything else we're saying, at least believe the scientists and the numbers that are showing you that your overall physical health can improve. So, by just practicing a little bit of gratitude.
Doesn't cost you a thing.
Nothing.
Doesn't cost you a thing. All the money that you pay for weight loss, lipo, not saying that those things don't have their place. But before you get to that route, try to practice these things while you're trying to decide what you want to do. But it will help so much. Your outlook is, I can't even say it's so important. It is so, so important on how you see yourself and how it affects your body's makeup.
Yes.
However, gratitude can backfire. You can kind of have an overdose of it and it's like ad nauseum. Like, okay, gratitude is not... It's, I mean, it has its place, and we're not obviously what we just said, but if you're going to focus on feeling grateful for someone and they're not worthy of that, and you kind of put that on them, like they should be grateful, and then you get upset because they're not grateful for something that you did, then it's misplaced. And you can use it to kind of cop out on certain things and to avoid a serious problem and make excuses. Oh, mm-hmm. It's not that bad. Well, you know, they were nice about this and they seem grateful for this, that, and it could be toxic. Mm-hmm. And you're down, you know, it's just, it's too much. Then you're downplaying your own success through excessive gratitude. You know, some people, you know, there's, it's like the other extreme of the imposter syndrome. Like some people are like, I don't think I'm good enough to do X, Y, Z. And then you get to the other side of, oh, it's just nothing. It's me. It's just, I'm just thankful. And that's great, but give yourself props. Just give yourself, you know, because it's a fulfilling feeling for you that you've made those accomplishments and you're thankful that you're able to get to that point. And then mistaking gratitude for indebtedness. Like, well, I said thank you and they should have said thank you. Like, you do something expecting that person to say thank you because you did it. That means,
or
why did
you do it? Indebted to you forever.
Right.
Like, gratitude.
I did that for them and they can't do anything, you know, or you bring it up all the time. Cause there's this one person that I had that is an associate in my life. Every time I talk to this person, be like, remember that time I did this for you? Remember, really? It was like 30 years ago. Really? And I said, thank you. What else do you want from me? Like, seriously. And then you, like, they remind you. Yeah. You know, remember I told you about the, okay. Yeah, I remember but I've moved on. And some people are stuck on that and they believe that everybody owes them something because they did something for them, expecting that person to be grateful for them, build, like, have, hold them in high regard, homage, like whatever. And you're just looking at them like, yo, I said thank you. I don't know what else you want from me. Like, I don't, what, you want my firstborn? Like, it's just, some people just take it to a whole other level.
They do.
And it's just, you know what, and then those people turn you off from wanting to be grateful, unfortunately.
Right.
But yeah, it's just
And you know, we're talking about, it's weird, we're talking about gratitude, and one of the things we always do when we talk about these things, whether it's self-care, whether it's decluttering your shit, whether it's like re-examining the friendships in your life, whatever it is, like how to practice, how to forgive people, one of the things we always do is give you ways to maintain these things, cultivate these things, foster these things. And of course, we do have ways for you to cultivate, foster, and maintain perspective. And this will actually help you with practicing gratitude on a regular basis, but will also keep you from being in a situation where the gratitude is backfiring and it's not really giving what it's supposed to have gave. Right?
That part.
So if you think about it, gratitude, all gratitude really is just a shift in perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Right? it helps you. It's a tool. Gratitude is a tool. So look at gratitude as a tool. Self-care is a tool. Gratitude is a tool. Forgiveness is a tool that can transform you from having feelings of lack. Lack is big.
Yeah.
Absence, deficiency, frustration, or scarcity to feelings of abundance, satisfaction, faith, and true wealth, right? The last episode, we talked about how to find your purpose. Gratitude for finding your purpose is big. Be thankful if you are one of those people who has been able to find their purpose. Mm-hmm. Or have gratitude for being put on a path to being able to find out what your purpose is, right? Because, and gratitude, like you said, it's not about the big things.
It's the little things.
It's stuff that we really should stop and be grateful for. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Wake up in the morning and just take a beat. Take some time.
Take the fact that you woke up.
Right. Be grateful.
The fact that you woke up. Last night I was late, sitting in bed. Before I went to sleep, I was sitting there watching TV. I don't even know what was on. And I had a moment because of some stuff that happened this week and I had to go to the hospital. And I really sat in bed and thinking about this episode today. And I sat there and I was just like, there is no guarantee that I'm going to wake up tomorrow at all. There is no guarantee that I'm going to get up and walk out this bed or do anything to that effect. But I'm sitting here setting my alarm, expecting myself to wake up tomorrow to get ready to film this, to see y'all, and realizing that I just have to be thankful for this moment and thankful for the fact that I'm able to lay down in my bed because I slept in an emergency room for 20 hours the day before. I'm being able to sleep in my bed last night. That is something that, you know, people may take for granted, and looking at the folks that were in the emergency room with me that clearly were homeless and did not and were and had different healthcare issues and challenges and what have you. But that little snippet within the past 24 hours just amplified how grateful I am for where I am, being in bed, being able to go to sleep, setting my alarm with the expectation that I was going to wake up today. Yeah. And wake up and just be thankful for the opportunity to even sit here and talk with y'all about gratitude.
Yeah.
And it's so powerful. Like, it really was just kind of gave me a moment to sit and be like, damn, this is, yeah.
But that leads into confronting your own mortality.
Yeah.
That is a way to help foster and cultivate gratitude. When you confront your own mortality and you say,
yeah,
I have, like, tomorrow is not promised.
I'm telling you.
What's that song? Tomorrow is not promised.
Who sing that?
So won't you give life today?
Yes. We on show tunes today, y'all. Yeah.
So when you think about that and you realize that life is precious, it really helps you be thankful in the moment.
Yes. It really does.
It really just helps you take a beat and say, whew, thank you. Thank you. You can keep a gratitude journal. There is a kit that I said I was going to purchase. It's on www.live-inspire.com. It is a year of gratitude kit, and it helps to inspire 52 weeks of giving thanks. And the kit invites you to make room for gratitude in your life with one thank you card to send each week. And there'll be 52 note cards, tips on writing a meaningful note, and a journal to keep track of your thoughts and your reflections. It includes a guided journal to chronicle your year of gratitude, an elegant box to keep in your desk for convenient writing, and then 13 each of 4 unique card designs.
So I get it.
This is also something, you know, Christmas will be upon us soon. Mm-hmm. So if there are, you know, people in your life that you think would benefit from this or would appreciate a gift like this, this is definitely something I think you could put on your Christmas list.
Definitely.
I would say try to get it soon because, you know, they talk about the shipments and stuff.
Right.
Still at the ports and they ain't got no drivers. And
right. All
you know,
that.
Even all this AI, artificial intelligent technology. And you telling me a bitch can't get a
no,
damn
girl.
Paw Patrol toy.
No. Because it's on a barge. It is on a barge. Sitting in a dock somewhere. with everybody else's stuff and the chips and the chips for the cars.
Yes. So I'm just telling you now, get it while you can.
You can get it by February, by Valentine's Day.
Yes. 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 Oh, you know what this would be good for? A teenager.
Oh.
Or a child. Teaching them to appreciate gratitude, right?
That's so true.
Helping them learn how to do it now.
Yes.
So that when they get older, they will appreciate it. Like I did with my grandma, and like you said, with your parents.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
They made us sit down and write that. Whew.
Yes. And it's been, and teaching your kids how to write.
Yeah, that part.
These kids just want to text and type and. Mm-mm.
Oh, I said, do y'all know how to write an envelope? They were like, what? I said, oh my Lord.
Why did I just find out that these people don't know how to cursive write?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They stopped cursive years ago. Years ago.
I love cursive writing.
I love cursive writing, too. I don't know. When my son came here and we were trying to go through stuff and he was like, Mom, I don't know how to do that. I said, I'm sorry.
What
do
you mean?
He's like, how do you sign your name? He was like, I just write it. I said, people can duplicate your signature and steal your money. He was like, oh, my God. That kind of shook him. And then he figured out it's cursive.
I just don't. Printing is so basic to me and just so ghetto.
It is basic.
Like, cursive.
Printing is ghetto.
I just feel fancy when I write in cursive.
Fancy,
so
huh?
I don't understand this.
I want to learn calligraphy.
Shit. You know what?
I definitely want to learn calligraphy.
Calligraphy is, yes.
So pretty.
Calligraphy
it's
would be
art
dope.
Form. Yeah. Let's find a
calligraphy
class.
Calligraphy would be dope.
Let's find a class.
Ooh, let's find a class. You know, we got two classes to take now.
Yes.
Okay, so there's three classes. See, I'm grateful for our friendship, and here's why. Because I have somebody I can do this shit with.
Yes.
I want to learn how to be, I will never do it because I know it's intensive, but if there's like a basic class on how to be a wine sommelier.
Yes,
I would love to do that.
You know who does that? The grape, what do you call them? Smashing Grapes? They have sommelier classes or something like that.
I would love to take a sommelier class.
Or something. I saw that.
So, husband, if you're listening, that is a great Christmas gift to give to your wife.
I like that. I like that. Sommelier.
Yes. So,
what were the other two classes?
Oh, makeup.
Yes.
And.
Yes.
Calligraphy.
Yes.
So I'm grateful. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay.
Grateful for you too.
We can, cultivate and maintain and foster, gratitude by learning prayers of gratitude.
Mm-hmm.
You can find prayers of gratitude probably in the Bible. You can Google search and find, prayers and maybe say a prayer in the morning and say a prayer in the evening, or just take a beat and stop and say a prayer, and just say, I'm just grateful. I'm just thankful. Mm-hmm. And just be mindful, be in the moment and be present.
Yes.
Use visual reminders, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this is important. Sometimes some of us are visual learners. Some of us learn by reading. Some of us, learn orally where we just have to repeat the same thing over and over again. But sometimes for some of us, gratitude has to be visual. We have to have visual reminders of being gratitude, of practicing gratitude, of being grateful for the things in our life.
Mm-hmm.
I'll say there's one thing that it's like going looking at my student loans because I'm trying to see if I can get these bitches canceled because of this public service loan forgiveness thing.
Yes.
And I was like, you know what? I try to be grateful that I was put in a position that I was allowed to go to undergrad, go to law school. But I can't be grateful for these fucking loans. I'm sorry. I just can't. I cannot.
They're like the bane of our existence. It's like a bill that just won't go away.
Right. So, I'll say this. As we, each of these episodes that we have, I actually move forward with implementing a lot of the things that we talk about, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some of the things I've implemented in my life before, but there's some things that we've learned during our research that I'm like, oh, okay, let me start implementing this. And gratitude is one of those things that I definitely said I wanted to, practice more and be mindful more about.
Mm-hmm.
And the one thing I said, I was like, how can I find gratitude in even the things that I don't like, right? Or where can I find some gratitude in this? Because I don't want to always be a negative Nancy just complaining and bitching about something.
Right.
So I said, you know what? I'll be grateful for the fact that I have a job.
Amen.
That allows me to make these payments. Amen. So they don't go in default. So my credit don't get fucked
Preach.
Up.
Preach.
So I will be grateful for that.
Yes.
I will be grateful for, you know, them not asking me to pay all this back in
all
one
at once.
Sum.
Basically, you have to mortgage your house. Here's the right. damn payment. And then you have nowhere to live.
Exactly.
But yeah.
So visual reminders, you know, maybe, you know, if you just have notes up.
I have notes all behind me.
Yes.
In my office.
Well, the degrees are some notes.
Well, those two. Those two. Those are notes of gratitude that I'm like, here you go, Penny Mac. Here you go, whoever, and Fannie Mae. Here you go. Yes.
But I'm going to tell you what I'll be grateful for the most. If Joe Biden.
Hello.
Come out and
come
say,
through.
I'm forgiving all these bitches. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Come on, Joe.
Praise
come on,
dancing.
Joe. Come on, Joe. We did it, Joe. Come on.
We did it, Joe.
We did it, Joe.
So, and that will be a visual. I will post that
yes.
somewhere to be visually reminded of. Thank
Hello.
You. Hello. Thank you. Thank
yes.
you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Watch your language.
That is
this
so
is
important.
Big. We Huge. Need to watch our language. Especially, you know, you were just talking about imposter syndrome. A lot of us self-deprecate.
Yes.
A lot of us hide behind negative words and negative affirmations mm-hmm. about ourselves and about our situation and about our circumstance. And yes. language, words have
power.
Meaning.
They have
and
power.
Words have power. They have a lot of power.
Mm-hmm.
You can definitely speak things into,
yes.
into existence. There are people who don't understand, there are self-fulfilling prophecies.
Mm.
And you may not believe it, but I had seen it.
Yes.
It is true.
So true.
I have seen it. Okay. Self-fulfilling prophecies are absolutely real. There are people who will talk so much, so like, I'm never gonna get this. I'm never gonna get this. I'm never gonna get this. Never
yes,
get it.
And never do. It is
your
so
tongue is powerful.
You're listening to yourself every time you speak something. You speak, it's like you keep reinforcing it and you hear mm-hmm. it and you say it and you hear it and you say it is so important. And I think one of my other friends that was I was out with somebody and this individual said something that was quite self-deprecating. And I didn't know this person. And I said, whoa, whoa, what's that all about? And I think, you know, she was kind of put off that I attacked her about what she was saying. Cause she's like, who this bitch gonna talk to me about me talking about myself.
Mm-hmm.
And my other friend was like, no, you need to understand, like when Natalie's good for telling somebody to stop talking negative about themselves, because it is something you believe and you internalize. And then it just keeps personifying in everything that you do. You really have to think about what you say, how you say it, how often you say it, because it will manifest
it will.
Into what you think it that you're talking about, and you begin to believe it.
It will. And you know, you think about how you can have someone talk to you. Like for some people, having other people saying negative things about them has a huge impact, right?
Right.
So just think about how your words could have a huge impact on you.
Yeah.
If you feel like somebody talking shit to you is not good,
right.
has a negative impact, makes you feel like crap, why do you, when you think that you doing the same thing to yourself is
yes.
not going to have the same effect? It's
self-verbal abuse. Yeah.
It's self-verbal abuse.
I don't think we've ever talked about it in that light. And I think that makes sense, because when you think about how individuals, if there's abusive relationships, verbally, emotionally abusive, and you talk about people talking to you and how that can break you down mentally in so many ways. And if you're sitting with yourself and you're with yourself 24/7 and you're talking about yourself like that too, it's inevitable that thing is going to seep into the back of your mind, and then you're going to begin to live that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that makes, yeah, the self-abuse thing, self-verbal abuse is real.
It is very real. And I'll say this, y'all know, I'm one of those people, other people's words don't bother me.
Mm-hmm.
What you think about me is none of my business, right? I'm not one of those people that, like, stews over what someone has said about me or thinks about me, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I know where that stems from, right? I know where that comes from. And I'm not saying that that's a good thing or a bad thing. I'm just telling you, you
right.
can come to my face right now and be like, you ugly old raggedy head bitch. And I just look at you like, okay. Like, I just, it doesn't, words just don't bother me. Okay. And it stems from, I grew up in a house, in a family where we clowned people all the time. Everybody got clowned. Nobody was safe. And I'm not saying that that's a good thing.
Right.
Because clearly my uncle to this day still thinks that he could just say shit to us.
Right.
And it's okay. I'll give a good example of this. And this is what I mean by watch her language. My sister, she's going to hate that I said this. But my sister went to an event not too long ago for my cousin. And my uncle was there. And my uncle is my cousin's father. And he sees my sister. And of course, we're older. We've had children. So we've all put on, of course, we're not going to look the same at 40 and 45 as we did at 20 and 25. It's just not possible. So he says to my sister, oh, hey, how you doing? You're looking a little more spatial than usual.
Spatial? Lord.
Oh my God. Now, if me and my sister weren't cut from the cloth that we were,
right,
that shit would bother us.
Correct.
But it didn't. And my sister was, me and my sister were laughing at it, right? And I said, well, what did you say? She's like, I just ignored him. I said, if it was me, you know what I would have said? I would have said something like, you look a little bit more crypt keeper than usual. You're looking like a little more sunken in than usual. A little more crackheadish. I don't know. What?
Oh, dear.
But watch your language is what I'm saying.
Yes. That's the moral of the story. Watch your language.
The moral is,
words have power. The power of the tongue is massive.
It just is.
It and is massive.
Once you learn that, you'll be better off.
Yes.
And lastly, one of the biggest things that we all can do is, if you're not a big prayer, if prayer is not your thing. Because again, when we'll talk about this, there's a difference between being religious and being spiritual.
Yes.
Being grounded in a particular, and just being grounded in, you know, a higher power.
Yeah.
Meditate. I promise you, if you just sit, take some time, sit in a corner, be quiet, light a candle, put on a diffuser, have some aromatherapy going on, you know, get
crystals, whatever you do.
Right. Whatever it is, just sit and meditate and just practice gratitude for all that you have in your life. Everything. I mean, be grateful that you have, you know, I was complaining about some, when I had my dental, I had to get this implant, and I was complaining about them. I was like, oh, I got to pay this, I got to pay that. And I stopped and I was like, but you have the means to do it.
Yeah.
And there are people walking around with four teeth missing, and they can't afford.
That is real.
To get this type of work done. So just be thankful.
Yes.
Don't complain about it. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I know. You don't want to pay it, but
you have it to pay.
Right. I'm getting new flooring next week. I'm in here, bitch, and I gotta spend that.
Yeah.
At least I have a place to live.
Amen to that. We had to talk about cussing out our deck people, our patio people had to come and pull up everything. And then they had to come. We were like, we are just not happy. And then we thought about it. I'm like, but we have the means to even put a patio on our home. So, you know, you got to really, things are, it's a perspective shift.
It's a perspective thing. It's so always big. Perspective.
Always perspective.
And meditate. I'll say this. I meditated yesterday because I, you know, we've been trying to get a new house. And it's just been difficult. And not because, it's been difficult because this area is so expensive that we just can't in good faith say, I'm going to pay $650,000 for this house. When 3 years ago, this house was $450,000.
That part.
And I know that I could get this house someplace else for $250,000. It's just hard. It's hard to really sit there as a grown person and knowing better and not doing better, right? So I sat and I was like, but it bothers me, right? Because I want a new house. We want a new house. We want new space. We want more space for our daughter, for us. And I said, you know what? Stop. clear your mind. What is this really about? What do you need to be thankful for in this moment? And when I did that, I said, you're right. I'm grateful. I have a house. My husband, he still has his own property. That in itself is a feat, right? I could pay my mortgage every month. Mm-hmm. No issues. My daughter is happy. She's healthy. We have created a home for her that is happy and healthy. It is a blessing. Mm. And so just be blessed that you have this space. Be grateful that you have this space.
Amen.
And just be mindful that there are other people who are in worse situations than you.
Especially you after this
here
year.
Right. You really sitting here complaining that you can't see yourself getting a $650,000 house. And there's people who can't even afford rent for $650 in places that rent is subsidized.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's more about ego. And that's something we're going to talk about. Our mm-hmm. ego will get and infiltrate Woo! Things.
Yes.
And put us in situations.
So many.
And have our mind messed up.
Real
it will disrupt
up.
Your
it
ego will
destroy
will disrupt,
you.
It will disrupt your life.
Yes.
It will disrupt relationships.
Everything.
It will disrupt gratitude. So I had to check my ego and I let it go.
Yeah. It's hard. It's a challenge. It's not gonna happen overnight.
It ain't easy. It isn't easy.
It's not for the faint of heart.
It isn't. And this I'll tell you this last thing before we go to break. This episode actually, probably for me, was one of the more emotional episodes in terms of doing the research and thinking about it, because it really forces you to be mindful of the things that are the most important things in your life.
Right. And it's not the material that most people think, because most people will think they'd be thankful for a material gift. Mm-hmm. And that's how they think gratitude should be expressed, because I got something material. There was a transaction. Mm-hmm. There was something given in return that they can touch or see or something to that effect. And that's really not.
It's not.
Where it is.
It's not where it is. And if you look at our love languages, right? We've done an episode on what the five love languages are. There's mm-hmm. gratitude in all of that. You can express gratitude through all of the love languages.
All of them. In your own unique way.
In your own unique way. And you're right. It's not material. It's like you have to get away from, yes, be thankful that you can do these materialistic things. But sometimes it's being thankful that you can breathe.
Mm.
There are people on ventilators right now.
Yes. That right there.
Because science is not real to them.
Oh, my goodness. Lord.
Be grateful that you have a mind that says science is real.
And that you accept that fact.
Right.
And can process it. Because some folks cannot.
No.
I'm thankful for my faculties every day, especially after that man next to me had a full-ass conversation with all three of himself the other day. I was just sitting there like, I am so glad that I have my mind intact.
Yes.
Because that is real.
That in and of itself. An intact mind.
Yes. And it's seeing it on display and seeing this man talk to himself and the different people he was talking to. Just, and I know, you know, sometimes, yes, it's comical, but it's real. You really, I'm sitting here that I can even analyze the fact that this man is not talking to anybody else but himself.
Just, yeah. I mean, gratitude is just one of those things that really makes my heart full.
Mm-hmm.
It makes me, it does just put everything into perspective for me. It makes me just look at everything that I have and just, you know, take it in. And it gives me a sense of peace to know that I understand gratitude at a deeper level now.
Mm-hmm.
And that I understand what it takes to keep that level of gratitude in my life. But we're going to take a quick break and come back with our last sip of the day. So this is the last sip of tea with your hood Dalai Lama. Gratitude turns what we have into enough and more. It turns denial into acceptance, chaos into order, confusion into clarity. It makes sense of our past, brings peace for today, and creates a vision for tomorrow. And that is attributed to Melody Beatty. So as we approach this Thanksgiving season, it is a perfect time to take a break, take a moment, and practice gratitude and to give thanks. Gratitude is one of many positive emotions. It's about focusing on what's good in our lives and being thankful for the things we have. Gratitude is pausing to notice and appreciate the things that we often take for granted, like having a place to live, food, clean water, friends, family, and even computer access. Gratitude can help us feel more positive emotions, relish good experiences, improve our health, deal with adversity, and build strong relationships. While gratitude is pleasant, it isn't always easy. We have to continue to work at it. So keep on working. And that is the last sip of tea with your Hood Dalai Lama.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you all for joining us this week on Sipping Tea with Nat and Z. You can follow us on Instagram at @SippingTea_NatandZ_pod and on Facebook at @SippingTeaNatandZ to get information on upcoming podcasts, guests, and news. Thanks for listening and catch us next episode where we talk about Mean Girl Syndrome. Be well and be thankful and be grateful, y'all.